Welcome to another episode of Stuff You Should Know About IP. We are here today with special guest and good friend Jan Willem Hoedemakers. He is a chemical engineer by trade and a European patent attorney, currently working as head of IP for a technology licensor in the Netherlands. And Jan Willem, you have a really interesting story that you wanted to share with us and about trademarks and trademark infringement. And so I'm just going to kick it off straight to you. Why don't you share this interesting story that you were telling us the other day?
Yes, this is the story of a British comedian who decided to change his name to Hugo Boss. You've definitely heard of Hugo Boss.
Absolutely.
And the reason, he did that was he also presents a program on one of the British TV channels where he acts as a sort of consumer champion and for small businesses. So he found out this story about this small company, very small microbrewery called Boss Breweries. Mind you, not Hugo Boss Breweries, but Boss Breweries. And they received a letter from Hugo Boss, you know, the big fashion brand, that they should stop calling themselves Boss Breweries, and they couldn't produce Boss beer anymore because they were infringing the trademark of Hugo Boss.
Yes.
So, and I was thinking of my friend Tom, who knows a bit about trademarks and trademark infringement, and I had just a couple of questions. Like, one, the first one, is it possible to change your name to a trademark? And the second is, if you have a brewery called Boss Breweries, is that actually infringing a trademark for a fashion brand called Hugo Boss?
Yeah, those
were my questions.
Yeah, those are great questions, Jan Willem. And by the way, I'm thrilled that you're doing this with us today, Jan Willem. As I've told you before, you're at least one of my top 20 favorite people on the planet. And considering there's 7.5 billion people and you're in my top 20, that's pretty good. I mean, I'm not that impressive. So, you know, maybe the top 20 of my list doesn't mean much, but you absolutely are.
Yeah. How many friends do you have, Tom?
I've got 18. So you're in the top 20. I know 18 people. So you're in the top 20.
Okay. Well,
now,
I feel
you're in the top 20. Honest. Your wife's in the top 15 because she's got a better personality than you.
But of course. Yes.
Anyway, that's a great question. So you turned me on to this case. I had never heard of it. This guy, Joe Lysette, changes his name to Hugo Boss as a protest against Hugo Boss's treatment of some small companies that they're suing. And when I first heard it, I had the same two questions you had. You know, one of your questions is, can you even change your name to a trademark name? And here's the answer. Yes, you can. Then the question is, can you use your name as a trademark, which he is not doing? So, but yes, you can, but there used to be this thing in the early 90s and before that as well, called your own name defense, right? So you're sued for trademark infringement for using your own name on products and services, and there was an own name defense, so you could always use your own name. And I still kind of had that in the back of my mind because when I grew up in law, that was the law, right? All over the world, you could have an own name defense. So when I went and did some research on it, I discovered the own name defense has been severely limited. And in terms of trademark use, but you could always have a name, right? You could always have your name. So Joe Lysette changes his name to Hugo Boss so that he can start talking about what Hugo Boss is doing, which is him. So yeah, he can do that. But then the question is, why would Hugo Boss prevail against the Boss Brewing Company? And the first thing you got to think about is, let's look at trademark infringement law, right? All over the world. What's one of the key elements for trademark infringement? One of them is likelihood of confusion. And one of the ways you determine that is, well, yes, similarity of the marks, but also similarity of the products or services. Like, for example, if you're a harmonica company and you brand your harmonicas Ferrari, they're not similar at all, right? So you'd think there's no way there's a trademark infringement issue. Or let's use another creative one. A clothing company called Hugo Boss pursuing a beer company called Boss Brewing Company. They're not even close to the same products. And no one in the marketplace would ever think that Hugo Boss, the clothing company, would create a brewing company. It's just too dissimilar. So my first thought was, well, why would they even give in? There's no trademark infringement issue. But I forgot about trademark dilution. So another cause of action in the world of trademarks, in addition to trademark infringement, is something called trademark dilution. Have either of you guys heard of trademark dilution?
I think I've heard the term, but I don't really know what it means. Well, I thought it had to do with if a trademark was used as a generic term like Velcro.
Oh no, that does happen. Yes, a very well-known and strong trademark like Velcro. And by the way, Velcro, just so we're clear, is still a trademark. But they're worried that Velcro could become generic and lose its trademark significance. But in this case, anti-dilution is intended to protect a select group of trademarks that are called famous trademarks. You know, McDonald's is a famous trademark. Ferrari is a famous trademark. And apparently, Hugo Boss is a famous trademark. And the law of anti-dilution all over the known world is essentially you cannot use a famous trademark regardless of your products or services. So if it's famous, if it's reached the status of famous, even if you have a totally dissimilar non-competitive product like a brewing company against a clothing company, you still can't use it. So,
but they aren't using it.
Exactly.
They're not called Hugo Boss Breweries.
Jan Willem. I totally agree with you. And that is, okay, so the second question is, you don't have to prove likelihood of confusion anymore when you're in the world of anti-dilution. You do not have to prove similarity of products in the world of anti-dilution. But, like you pointed out, Jan Willem, you do have to prove a similarity of the trademarks. For example, let's be extreme. Hugo Boss sues me for having my company called Gadget Inc. You know, they'd say, you know, we're a famous mark, so you're diluting our mark by using Gadget Inc. And I'd say, wait a second, Gadget is even close to Hugo Boss. Okay, now let's get a little bit closer. Let's call the company Boss Brewing. Mm-hmm. To me, the significance of Hugo Boss is number one, Hugo, right? That's way more powerful than Boss. I mean, Bruce Springsteen's probably dying over the fact that people have been calling him the boss a long time, and now maybe they can't do that anymore, right?
Yeah.
And boss is just such a generic term. I mean, if we did a Google search right now, we'd probably find a ton of companies using boss as part of their products. Well, apparently Hugo Boss would go after them. So I agree with you, Jan Willem. I don't think, if I had to fight this, I'm their attorney. Boss Brewing Company calls me, Tom Coulson, and says, will you represent us? Assuming I could figure out a way to do that in the EU, which I can't, but assuming I could, I'd love to take that case on. Because I don't care if your mark is famous, Mr. Hugo Boss. They're not using Hugo Boss. They're using Boss Brewing. And to me, it's not causing dilution. It's not causing tarnishment. Now, you may know this. They get to keep using Boss Brewing. They finally settled on changing the names of two of their beers. Did you read that, Jan Willem?
Yeah, I heard that, yeah.
Yeah, one of the beers still, they were calling...
This was a bit of a problem. You say you would be willing to take this one on. This poor Boss Brewing Company, they said they spent about £20,000 in litigation.
In four months. Yeah.
Which is a huge amount of money if you are a microbrewery.
Exactly.
So the problem for them was not that they didn't want to fight it. The problem was that at some point they couldn't anymore because they didn't have the money. And £20,000, I think, is probably somewhere between $25,000 and $30,000. So that's quite a lot of money for a small company.
Exactly. So that's one of the, now, if you happen to be a famous brand, what does that also mean? You're probably big, right? I mean,
absolutely.
You probably have a lot of money. So you can bully other companies that are small, like the Boss Brewing Company, because they can't defend themselves. What if they were called the Gadget Brewing Company and still they were sued by Hugo Boss? There's no way they could lose that case, but they can't afford to defend themselves, right?
Yeah.
So which, enter Joel Iset, right? Enter Joel Iset. Why? Because he's sympathetic to the little guy. You know, it's just not fair, because even though they're probably right that Boss Brewing Company is not diluting, it's not blurring or tarnishing the mark of Hugo Boss, because it's not close enough in terms of the marks, they don't have any money to defend themselves. And you're right, £20,000 for a microbrewery is painful. I mean, that's right out of your, you're not eating good dinners for like 3 months. You can't eat at your own brewery for like 3 months, right? You have to go home and eat your ramen noodles while all your friends are eating at your brewery, because you just spent $20,000 on some attorney like me to defend yourself against Hugo Boss, and you couldn't spend anymore, so you couldn't actually win. You had to finally give in. So then,
I was wondering if you would do it cheaper, but
yeah. If we could go back in time, if you invent the time machine, Jan Willem, and we go back in time, I will represent them for free, pro bono. Okay.
Yeah. Oh, okay. That's great.
And then you know how I'll get paid? I'll get paid on licensing revenues from your time machine, right?
Oh, yes, absolutely.
That's right. So what do they have to do? They have to change the name. One beer was called Boss Black. They were forced to change it to Boss Brewing Black. And when I say forced to, the courts did not force them. They were running out of money, I'm sure. Hugo Boss negotiated with them, and they said, okay, fine, what do you want us to do? And then Joe Lysette pops onto the scene, and he's shaming Hugo Boss, right? So they're getting a little bit of pressure that way. So they're like, okay, fine, look, let's just change Boss Black to Boss Brewing Black. And they're like, okay, whatever. And then they said, now you have a beer called Boss Boss. Now, we don't like that, because you're using Boss twice. Now, you're not using Hugo at all, but you're using Boss twice. So that maybe makes up the fact that you didn't use Hugo. So they made him change it to Boss Bossy, okay? B-O-S-S, B-O-S-S goes to B-O-S-S, B-O-S-S-Y, Boss Bossy. And now everybody's good, except the Boss Brewing Company, who's out £20,000.
Yeah, they are not happy.
No, but let's look at the bright side for them, maybe. Because this got so much press, and because Joel Iset did his thing, maybe they're getting, although there's a pandemic going on, so they can't get any customers now, but maybe if they could keep this in the news long enough, the moment, the very instant the pandemic ends, people will race to the Boss Brewing Company and buy their Boss Bossy and their Boss Brewing Black to make up for the £20,000 they lost.
Yeah. And maybe they can set up an online business and send all the beer, because I'm sure that this kind of publicity you can't really buy.
That's right. Yeah. Here's the irony. They don't have the money to buy this kind of publicity, right?
No. No, you know, they have coverage on national TV.
That's right.
Which normally such a small company would never get.
Right, so they spent 20,000 pounds sterling on advertising, which they would have normally had to spend 100,000 or 200,000, or maybe a million before they got national recognition, international recognition, you know? Because I'll tell you, the first time I go to the UK, I'm going to the Boss Brewing Company. On my next trip to the UK, I'm going to the Boss Brewing Company.
Yeah. That would be fun. Let me know and take me. If afterwards you come to the Netherlands, bring me a couple of bottles of beer.
Yes. As soon as this pandemic ends and we can go on planes again, my next trip, instead of having dinner at that German place we always have dinner at, that Indian place in Germany, whenever I come in, we're going to jump on a plane. Or no, maybe we'll take a car to the channel, and then we'll channel over and we'll go to the Boss Brewing Company.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
All right,
where in the UK it is.
Yeah, we have to, that small detail we'll have to figure out. So maybe we could email Joe Lysette and ask him.
Okay.
So you had another story, though, Jan Willem.
I had another one. This was when my wife was working in Portugal. There was a... She's working in Albufeira, which is a place where there are a lot of British people are living there. And there was a very small... it was a British couple who opened a supermarket, a very small supermarket. I mean, in terms of a surface area, not bigger than my house. And so
But your house is big enough to fit peacocks and goats, so...
That's true. But... See, and since they were targeting, they had a lot of British products, which were different from the Portuguese products normally in the supermarkets. And they decided to appeal to the British public, and they called themselves Harrods. Harrods. So it's clearly a play on words on Harrods, which is this big department store in London. So, guess what happened? They got a cease and desist letter from Harrods. They didn't appreciate that at all. So, now, interestingly here, Harrods also sells food and groceries and the kind of stuff that you can buy in a supermarket. So, they were actually selling a similar type of products. But this store was not, well, didn't resemble the real Harrods at all. It was in a small town, not even on the high street. It was just some side street, and so there was, I would say, risk of confusion, nil. And I don't know if the dilution would be the problem, and what their likelihood would be that they would actually have won the case. But similarly to the brewery, what happened was that they changed the name themselves, and they changed the name to Shelf and Fridges.
Shelf and Fridges?
Shelf and Fridges. Shelf, and then in inverted commas, and Fridges. I don't know if you're... apparently, they got away with that because there is a supermarket chain in the UK called Selfridges.
I did not know that.
Yeah, I thought you might not know that, but it's so Selfridges is one of the big supermarkets. So that was, would they be getting in trouble there? And what is the likelihood that that a court would rule against them in this particular case? Because it also has the aspect of being a bit tongue in cheek,
right?
And only the British people living in the area would actually get it, if you
right.
see what I mean.
Yeah,
and they would get the message, oh, you can buy some British products here.
Well, go back to Harrods, first of all. That's a department store? It's not a
grocery store? No, it's not a grocery store, but they do have food as well. And you can basically buy anything there.
Right.
I've been there once, and they have food, and vegetables, but you can also buy ancient fossils.
Okay. So I would say that their case of trademark infringement, classic trademark infringement, if of course they're using the mark in, didn't you say it was in Portugal?
In Portugal, yes.
Yeah. Is there a Harrods in Portugal?
Not that I know of.
Yeah, so
it's really associated with this big department store in London.
Right. So two things jump into my head. If number one, I don't know what the trademark laws are in Europe. There's this European trademark, right? Mm-hmm. I think there's a European trademark, which means your trademark rights apply all over Europe. Is that the basic idea?
No, what I do know is there is an EU trademark.
Yeah, the UK.
But also, there is also for every country, there's also national trademarks.
Right. But unlike patents in Europe, where you have to nationalize in each country, with trademarks, I think you can get an EU trademark that covers all the EU countries, right?
Yes.
So Okay, so if they have a registered trademark, it would apply in Portugal, assuming Portugal's part of the EU, and the UK was part of the EU at the time, right? So they have a better case for trademark infringement, classic trademark infringement, than anti-dilution, because with trademark infringement, you don't have to prove that you have a famous mark. That's one of the things about dilution. I think Hugo Boss would win on that particular element, which is proving you have a famous mark. But I don't know if Harrods would succeed on that. Maybe in the UK, they're very famous. I mean, maybe they're a well-known.
I think they're worldwide very, famous.
Have you heard of them, Ray?
Yeah, I heard of them when there's a place in New York City called Italy. It's like Italy, but with an E. And the buzz on the street when it was opening was that it was an imitation of Harrods in London. And I had never been to Harrods, but, you know, what you describe, Jan Willem, is what Italy essentially is. There's food, vegetables, meat. You can buy, like, cheeses. But also, it's a restaurant, and also it's like a story where you can buy other things. So
in this case, though, let's ignore the anti-dilution and just say trademark infringement. They probably have a reasonably good case because they're using the same exact word, except they've made it 1D instead of 2, right?
No, 1R instead of 2.
Oh, 1R instead of 2. Okay.
Yeah.
So and it's in a British area of Portugal, right? So they might have a pretty good case for that. But again, go back to the fact that they can't defend themselves against Herod, so they're gonna get crushed anyway. And then in terms of anti-dilution, you know, I don't know. I don't know if they're famous enough, but if they are, they have the same problem. So fundamentally, their biggest problem, I think their case is a lot harder than the Hugo Boss case, because Boss Brewing, I think, would be a much easier case to defend if you have the money than Harrods. But also, they're clearly trying to poke a stick at people. They're trying to
stick
it in his eyes, because first they do Harrods, then they go to this other place that's well-known in the UK. They're clearly trying to trade off their brand. I mean, whether it's tongue-in-cheek, I don't know, but clearly they're trying to get people to say, well, wow, that reminds me of that, and maybe there would be confusion.
That was clearly the intention, is to remind people of that brand, and thereby sort of making clear to their target audience, so to speak, and their target market, that they are selling stuff for a British public.
Right. Yes, exactly. Well, you know, in terms of the big guy and the little guy, it reminds me of my own town here, where Ray also grew up, by the way, Clarence, New York. And there's a company called the Clarence Pizza Company, which, by the way, used to be called the Pizza Inn. But they got a cease and desist letter for a company in Florida, which, as you may know, is probably 2,000 miles away or so, or 1,500 miles.
It's a long drive. It's several days.
I know from doing it, it's 22 and a half hours if you only stop for gas and don't stop for food. But anyway, so there's this little company called the Pizza Inn in Clarence, New York, which is a little tiny town outside of Buffalo, New York. They got a cease and desist letter. They were forced to either fight, which I think they probably would have. Well, this company actually had a trademark, a federally registered trademark, which for a pizza company, right? So they probably lost, because when you have a registered trademark, it gives you constructive use all over the nation. But they had to change their name to Clarence Pizza Company, which personally I think is a better name. But anyway, once again, they couldn't fight. And it all comes down to this. Other than your friends in Portugal with Harrods, who really wanted to poke a stick in their eye, they wanted to do that. Other than them, you should do searches. You should do the freedom to operate searches before you pick a name. It would not have helped Boss Brewing, though, because who would have thought, after doing a freedom to operate search, that Hugo Boss would create a problem for Boss Brewing, right? No one would have thought that. So,
Now, what if they had registered? Because I know that with trademark, you register them in certain classes.
Right, yeah.
Yeah,
so registration.
Services. Now, if they had their trademark registered, and let's assume that at that time, because I know you can have an opposition against the trademark for a certain period of time, But right. Let's assume it had escaped the attention of the eagle-eyed lawyers at Hugo Boss.
Right.
So they would have had a granted trademark for Boss Brewery. If they... Would it have been much easier for them to defend them in court against the cease and desist letter and to against Hugo Boss? You know, or would that they have made no difference?
Yeah, that it probably would have made no difference. But here's the thing. Think about it this way. Look at patents for a moment, because I know you're a patent expert. If you have a patent and I have a patent, I could still be committing patent infringement if I go to the marketplace if your patent is broader than mine, right?
Yeah.
If I have a patented product, it doesn't give me the right to go to the market with it. Trademark registration, though, should give you the right. And then what would probably happen is you still have your anti-dilution action, because you might get the mark Boss Brewing and the person doing the examination did not consider the anti-dilution aspects of it, because these people are not experts in everything, right?
Mm-hmm.
By the way, there is no anti-dilution. Let's ignore that fact for the moment.
Yeah.
But then I would say that there would probably still be a trademark infringement action, and maybe there'd be an invalidation of the Boss Brewing mark if it got to that point and if they were right. But I would say that it would not have changed the outcome one bit. And the primary reason for that is money. And as Ray and I have talked about on many of these podcasts, there is the law and then there's money. And if you have the money, you pretty much can do not anything you want, because there are cases where lawyers will take matters on a contingent basis and attack somebody for patent infringement or trademark infringement and take a third.
Not in Europe. Not in Europe.
Oh, they can't do that in Europe.
Wow. Well, I do not know about the I don't know about the UK, but I do know that in the Netherlands it's illegal for lawyers to work on a contingent basis. So they
to me that's unfortunate, because the advantage of the contingent only case, I mean, personal injury lawyers in the US get a bad reputation, right? Because they're but here's the reality. If you have to pay a lawyer, you will almost never get justice if you're a little guy. Never. The only hope people have to enter the justice system, I mean, in a civil action, is with contingent only lawyers. You take out the personal injury lawyers. There's even patent lawyers that'll take cases on a contingent only basis in the US. Used to be a big thing. There was these patent trolls out there. They're pretty much dying out, but it's the only way people can get redress. It's the only way people can get into the courtroom if you don't have a lot of money. The Boss Brewing Company couldn't sue anybody for trademark infringement or patent infringement or personal injury if they didn't have contingent only lawyers. So that's unfortunate, but you'll never get one to defend you, because if you're just defending yourself, there's no money in it. You can never get a lawyer.
The situation, is that in a lot of cases that if you win a case, a court will, in a judgment, will say that the other party has to pay your costs.
Hmm. Yeah. And in the U.S., that's the case as well, but it's not that normal. It's not.
See, that was my question is in this, because in this case with the Boss Brewing Company, it seems like it's not so clear cut and dry. I mean, obviously Hugo Boss has the power here, but it's a totally different product. The trademark doesn't even look that similar, and I'll put them on screen when we release this. But is there some kind of safeguard in place to prevent these big companies from bossing these people around, these smaller companies around? In this case, literally. And Jan Willem, you mentioned that you could recover damages in some places, at least, for legal fees. But what about the lost opportunity, and maybe having to cease and desist for a period of time, or having to focus all of your energy on defending yourself and not running your business.
You will never get that back. That is one of the things also which I believe in patent infringement. When you have a case of patent infringement, you will have your best people and your best technical people to support a particular case. Hmm. And in the end, it means that you don't use those particular people to do the best innovation you could have done.
Yeah, right, exactly. Yeah, you'll never get that.
You never get that paid. I don't think so.
Legal fees more likely in the EU than they do in the US. Maybe they give legal more. But even that, it's such a risk, because what lawyer is going to take a case? Maybe this case you might take, but it has to be a frivolous action to get legal fees, probably. If it's a legitimate action, you're not going to get legal fees. It's only probably in the cases where it's just totally clearly bullying or frivolous or something like that. So I think you'd be hard pressed. But again, if it wasn't for this global pandemic, Boss Brewing would have a benefit of all this advertising. I had this friend that was owned a company called the Buffalo Beast. It was a Buffalo newspaper, and he sold his trademark rights to the Daily Beast. And then he kept using his trademark. And every time they'd threaten him or sue him, he would bring that up, and he would get all kinds of publicity around the fact. He would show the complaints against them, you know, like he was getting a ton of publicity with all this litigation. And that's kind of what I feel